Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Celebration Community Church. We are a church of extravagant hospitality and a place of tradition without judgment. Now I need to pause a moment and turn and look at Keith. Keith, who did that? That wasn't Keith. Was it Scott? Did you do that? You did the chimes. Okay, we had a time change and I thought I had another hour before I had to come up here and start. Just tell it, okay? I'm just saying. Actually, I saved that up for Keith, so I'm sorry I don't have that on you instead. I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad you got the time change right. If you didn't get it right, you would have shown up for Pastor's Cup at 9. That would have been okay, too, but we're really glad that you're here. If you're visiting with us today, in a moment, we're going to pass a red notebook down the pew. And when we do, put your name in there. Give us your contact information so that we can put you on our list. We just tell you what we're doing. We promise we're not going to spam you. We won't stalk you. But we just want you to know a little bit more about us and be able to tell you about opportunities that we have that we can share with you here as part of Celebration. So again, thank you for being here. If you would, go ahead and let's start those red books down the pews, and I'm going to share with you a couple of announcements. By the way, we're missing some red books? Well, I'll tell you what. Pass them all the way across the aisle if necessary. We will make this happen. There you go. No, this is what we're about here. We take care of each other, so we're good. We're good. Also, if you're visiting with us, we gather down in our fellowship hall right after worship for a cup of coffee and a few minutes of just get acquainted. If you would, stay for a few minutes. You just head out this door, through the doors, into the next building, all the way to the end of the hall. We've got some folks who will help you find your way, and we really hope you'll come by and say hello. We're, again, very glad that you're here with us today. Let me share several announcements. Black Tie Dinner is coming up. It is less than two weeks away. It's 13 days away now. It's November the 16th. We still have some seats at tables. We'd love for you to come and be part of that with us. If you, the tickets are $500. If you can afford $500, buy a ticket, come sit with us. If you can't afford, let us know. We have some folks who might be able to sponsor. If you can't go, but you'd like to sponsor somebody, put that note next to your name in the red book. We'll get that, we'll reach back out to you. But that's coming up quick. It's important we support Black Tie Dinner. The reason it is, we are one of their beneficiaries. And like I shared with you last week, we have received over the years almost $500,000 in support for Black Tie Dinner. So it's good for us to give something back to them as well. The raffle's also going on. It closes November the 8th. There is a banner in the fireside room with a QR code. If you want to buy a raffle ticket to win... Ron's not here. I think it's the equivalent of a car. In this case, money towards a car. This is a great idea, so you go do that. That supports Black Tie as well. A couple of things I want to share with you. Feast of Sharing is coming up this Wednesday. It is something that Central Market and HEB puts on. It'll be at Dickey's Arena. We have opportunities to go over there and volunteer. When you volunteer, be prepared to stand for a few hours. Wear comfortable shoes. You're going to be helping serve dinner, picking up things, different stuff like that. This serves those members of our local community who are food insecure, they may be shelter insecure, they just may need to be around other people because they're lonely. And there are two shifts. There's an Adam looking at you, a 2:30 to 5:30, and then 4:30 to 7:30. All right, you sign up for either of those shifts, put it in the red book, which one you want to do, or call the office, and we'll put you down. We look forward to having you be part of that with us. I want to thank some people for their work yesterday on blessing the animals. Jackie Sharp, Karen Newberry, they're not with us today, but thank you. Claudia Knowles, Charla, where are you? Charla's in the, talk to Charla, she's up there in the choir, Charla. John, thank you all, and Karen Bone especially, for your help in blessing the animals yesterday. And we, those of you who were here, got to meet Phoebe yesterday. Looking at Jesse, where's James? So we're grateful that we met Phoebe. Blessing animals is an important thing to do, because our companion animals bring so much to us, and hopefully in our care for them, we give something back in return. Children's ministry. We are looking for volunteers. If you have a heart for kids, would like to help out teaching, as a teaching assistant, just as a substitute, we provide all the material that you need. We just need you. So if you're interested, I want you to see Danielle Bailey. Danielle, wave your hand back there. She is in charge of our children's ministry, and she would love to get your name. Let me say something else about Danielle, too. If you read the newsletter, you know this already. Danielle Bailey is our new assistant to the pastor starting December the 2nd. So wave your hand a second time. We put her picture in the newsletter so you know who she is, so you know who you need to go talk to now on Sundays. Daniel, I didn't tell you about this part of the job, but people will come to you and say, will you take care of this? Can you do this? It all happened on Sundays. So just have a notebook and be ready to go. We are thrilled that you're joining our team here at Celebration. Glad you're going to be part of that. This is the time when we do formally what we have been doing informally for the last 20 minutes in this room, where we greet one another with signs of love and peace. And so as you're able, would you stand? Let's pass the peace of Christ to one another. Those who are joining us today on Facebook or YouTube, we are grateful that you're part of our worshiping community as well. Let us remember as we go into worship on this All Saints Sunday that there's no place that we would rather be than right here, right now, with one another. Let us worship God together. Lift up your hearts.
Will you please join me in the call to worship? For those who have paved the way for our freedom of worship, we give thanks, O God.
For those who have taught us about witness and the power of love, we give thanks, O Lord.
For those who work in our church, that we may come to know what it means to serve, we give thanks, O Lord.
For all the saints, those who rest from their labors, and those who labor still, we give thanks, O Lord.
Praise be to God who continually inspires and guides workers and witnesses.
Open our hearts and spirits, O Lord, and help us to become good workers for you. Amen.
Let us pray. Faithful Redeemer, you are the beginning and ending of all things. You promise to wipe away every tear, that death and mourning will be no more. You make your home among us and abide with us as our God. Teach us to live as the saints you call us to be, that we may truly be your people, living and doing your will. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. And now, if you would like to join our Sunday school. You can follow Adam.
Good morning. Our opening hymn is 637. I invite you to stand as you are able as we sing For All the Saints.
Thank you.
reading from the book of Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of heavenly forces will prepare for all peoples a rich feast, a feast of choice wines, of select foods rich in flavor, of choice wines well refined. He will swallow up on this mountain the veil that is veiling all peoples, the shroud enshrouding all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Lord God will wipe tears from every face. He will remove his people's disgrace from off the whole earth, for the Lord has spoken. They will say on that day, "Look, this is our God for whom we have waited, and he has saved us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let's be glad and rejoice in his salvation." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
All Saints' Day was this past Friday. It is the day when the church remembers those who have gone on ahead of us. It is the day when we at celebration remember those of our community of faith who we have lost in the last year. In your order of worship is a litany. This morning we're going to share that litany with each other. As we do, as we share each name, I will light a candle for each of them. At the end of the litany, I'm going to take my seat, and I'm going to allow you, if you wish, to come up and light a candle for somebody you have lost in the past year, somebody that you want God to remember. So would you take and share the litany with me? God, we give you thanks for those who have gone before us, whose lives have shown us your truth, and whose witness brought us and kept us in this community of faith. Through Robin Coyer, who was willing to be everyone's best friend.
You showed us how to love each other. Sound of music and wellness.
Through Kathy Mazzone, strong, dependable, and caring.
We learned how to embrace life and love music, especially the Beatles and Sir Paul McCartney.
Through Jack Chaney, kind, gentle, and thoughtful.
We learned how to be first in line to help each other, always with joy and a smile.
Through Pat Stafford, who taught us the acceptance that all mothers can show.
He showed us how to accept each other through both of us and good food, lovingly prepared.
We trust in your never-failing love, O God, joining these holy ones in the presence of your merciful throne. Amen. Amen. I'm going to light one more candle this morning. This candle is not for any specific person. This candle are for all of those in our country who this year have fallen victim to gun violence. I invite you, we will take a moment, if there's somebody that you love, somebody that you want to remember, to step up to light a candle. If you wish, say their name, and then take your seat. Thank you.
from my mother-in-law, Elaine Roberg.
Jim Holman and Grandmother Annette Holman.
I light this candle for my dear friend Angela Van Story.
Family, lost family members this year.
For the names of Dan Rhodes and Pam Luttrell.
We give thanks to God for all of these lives. We give thanks to God for the lives that they touched. We give thanks to God that they live on in our lives as well. Amen.
Prayer hymn this morning is "Surely the Presence of the Lord is in This Place," hymn 263. I invite you to sing along with me.
I can feel His love.
One of the most important promises that are made, that is made to us, is that we are not alone. Whether we think about the people who are in this room with us this morning, the folks we're in community with in our neighborhoods, in our workplaces, in our extended families, whether we think about the ones we have named and others we have not named this morning that have gone on before us, and whether we think about the presence of God's Spirit in our lives and in this place, we know that we are not alone. That is the message of All Saints Day. If you will take your order of worship and look on the back, I want to share with you the names of several that we want to be in prayer for this morning. We want to be praying for our pastor search committee and the work that they do on our behalf. We pray for Angie Falzarano. We pray for Barb Meyer and Deb Payne. We pray for Becky Sneed, for Bonnie Watkins, for Karen Newberry, for Chris Foreman, for Connie Reese, for Joel Jocelyn and his family, for Lynette Bushnell, for Mona Martinez, for Ricardo Riley, and for many, many unspoken prayer requests. We pray this morning too, her name is not on your list, for a young woman by the name of Leanne Oliver. Leanne is Terry Pruitt's niece, and she was involved in a horrible automobile accident the other night and is severely injured in that accident. She needs our prayers. She needs something else. She's experienced a good deal of blood loss. And so if you donate blood, would you go do that this week? And I don't know how this works, so talk to Terry about it, but donate in her name, because that helps offset the cost for her and her family. But we pray for Leanne. We pray for healing for her. Would you bow your heads with me? To you, God, we bring all blessing and honor and glory. To bring you, God, we bring all of our wisdom and our praise and our thanks, for you are the God of our salvation. We pray in communion with all of the saints, both on earth and in heaven, with the martyrs and the faithful of all ages, and in the name of the Lamb who was slain, who alone is worthy of worship. We ask for your blessing upon us. We ask for your healing presence. We ask that you make us hungry for justice. We ask that you strengthen our faith. And we ask that you increase our love for each other. We ask, God, that you extend your arms to us as we extend our arms to each other in an embrace of love and goodness and community. Amen.
A reading from the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne say, "Look, God's dwelling is here with humankind. He will dwell with them, and they will be his peoples. God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. There will be no mourning, crying, or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." Then the one seated on the throne said, "Look, I am making all things new." He also said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." Then he said to me, "All is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will freely give water from the life-giving spring." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I
Election day is Tuesday, as if you didn't know. So let me check, how's your anxiety level? Mine? I'm at the point where I can crawl under my desk and curl up in the ball and not come out until Wednesday morning. So if you don't see me for 2 days, come around the desk and look underneath. That's probably where I'll be. I remember growing up with that kind of existential anxiety of the Cold War in Vietnam. I practiced duck and cover drills as a second grader at Bryan Elementary School, located 175 miles north of Havana during the Cuban Missile Crisis. I watched the evening news about the death toll in Vietnam as my 18th birthday drew closer and closer. And I struggled with the anxiety over whether Lynn Townsend liked me or Jed could dance. She liked Jed better. Each of us lives lives with our own unique anxiety, existential and otherwise. The serious or chronic illnesses that we battle, the deep anxiety that we have for those whom we deeply love, the attacks we experienced as an LGBTQ community, as society made its very slow way to grudging acceptance and affirmation, the raids on the clubs, the rejection by our families, the threats received from ambitious politicians, which continue seeking an other to rally their fearful followers against. I remember sitting in this sanctuary, sitting right about where Ben is, on Monday night, June 13th, 2016. We shared our anger and our anguish over the deaths at the Pulse nightclub in Orlando. And we shared different anxieties as a church. We began almost 32 years ago as an act of faith to establish a welcoming community of faith and worship, gathering in a variety of different places in the beginning, while hoping for a future that for us wasn't certain. We purchased this sanctuary to continue the worship of God in a place where others had worshiped before our founding. Its purchase was an act of faith that we hoped we could afford and maintain. We loved each other. We worked with each other, argued and disagreed with each other, made up with each other, and went to work again. There were times when I imagine we wondered if we could hold it all together. But we're still here, facing a new set of anxieties. All Saints Day is for those of us who live in anxious times. For the past 8 years, I've dealt with my political anxiety by rewatching The West Wing. It's a mix of idealism and pragmatism that appeals to me during a time when the world seems to be losing its mind. Now, the aspect of the show that appeals to me most is its portrayal of friendships, and especially the friendship between Leo McGarry and his deputy chief of staff, Josh Lyman. It seemed that a good deal of the time, Leo was trying to knock some sense into the impetuous and self-centered Josh, but there were moments of deep, deep affection. Now, I know the story I'm about to tell, I've told to many of you before, but that's the advantage of a good story. Sometimes you just have to tell it again. And one of my favorite stories comes from a scene from The West Wing where Josh is suffering from PTSD after being wounded in an assassination attempt on the president. He had withdrawn from a circle of friends and was struggling to find a way out of the depression and the despair that were overwhelming him. It nearly cost him his job. Leo found him and told him the following story. You see, this guy's walking down the street when he falls in a hole. And the walls are so steep, he can't get out. A doctor walks past, and the guy shouts, "Hey, you, can you help me out?" So the doctor writes a prescription, throws it down in the hole, and moves on. Then a priest comes along, and the guy shouts out, "Hey, Father, I'm down in this hole. Can you help me out?" The priest writes out a prayer, throws it down in the hole, and moves on. Then a friend walks by. "Hey, Joe, it's me. Can you help me out?" And our friend jumps into the hole. The guy says, "Are you stupid? Now we're both down here." The friend says, "Yeah, but I've been down here before, and I know the way out." I know the way out. The saints who came before us have been here before in everything that we're experiencing, and they know the way out. The voices in these stones that surround us in this sanctuary have been where we are now. And those voices say to us, I know the way out. The passages we read this morning from Isaiah and Revelation were written to a people living in anxious times. Whether it was the threat they faced from Babylon or Rome, the people hearing these words knew that their lives were going to be upended by powerful men who believed that they could take what they wanted no matter what the cost was to others. Those hearing the words of Isaiah were facing a world war. Babylon was on the march, and the contest between the empires of Babylon and Egypt would crush anyone in their paths, including the people of Israel, who were literally caught in the middle. And then there were prophets, Isaiah included, who told these anxious people that they were about to receive what God said they deserved. God was angry with them and would use these violent empires to punish them. Not precisely the word of comfort that you would hope to hear from a prophet. Now, I do believe that there are logical consequences to the actions that people take. And the narcissistic leaders of Israel had been trying to play the imperial power game with the big dogs instead of realizing that it would have been better to stay on the porch. For those kings of Israel were about to experience the truth of the saying, fool around and find out, or something to that effect. But their finding out would result in an awful harm to their people, most of whom were simply going about their lives. And the prophet's attempt to make meaning out of these imperial games just made the people more fearful and anxious. But suddenly the voice of Isaiah changes. The voice that said a moment earlier, God's going to get you, became the voice that said, the Lord of all heavenly forces will prepare for all peoples a rich feast, a feast of choice wines, of select foods rich in flavor, of choice wines well refined. That was the voice they needed to hear. The one that said, in the midst of their fear and anxiety, there is hope. The people who heard the words of Revelation were dealing with a different anxiety. It was their own government that was attacking them. The Romans claimed that these followers of Jesus were irreligious, treasonous, horrible people, human scum who were poisoning the blood of the country. These followers of Jesus were called immoral people who were recruiting children into their nefarious agendas. The Romans, who demanded a return to the old-time religion, accused these followers of wanting special treatment while they disrespected the family and marriage. Sound familiar? To these people, the writer of Revelation gave hope as they heard these words. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I heard a loud voice from the throne say, look, God's dwelling is here with us. God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Death will be no more. There will be no more mourning, no more crying or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Those who came before us found hope in these words. They told the story of how they overcame the fears and dangers that surrounded them. They told these stories to their children and their grandchildren for generations to come, that there will be a better day, that there is a way out. I don't know the outcome of this election on Tuesday. I should quit reading the polls because I try to predict. And when they go my way, I feel good. And when they don't, I get anxious again. You know, I'd love for once in my life to have the experience of a presidential election that wasn't such a nail biter, as long as it went the way I wanted it to. But I do know this. Regardless of the outcome on Tuesday, there is a way out. There is something better. There is a great banquet where anyone who eats bread at the table of God is blessed. I know this because I learned it from the saints, from the ancestors who came before us. Now, we may not all get there at the same time. We may still have to deal with our fear and our anxiety. If this election goes badly, we may have to admit that the poet Clint Smith was right when he wrote these words. When people say we have made it through worse before, all I hear is the wind slapping against the gravestones of those who did not make it. Do not say I'm hopeless. I believe there is a better future to fight for. I simply accept the possibility that I may not live to see it. Some of our ancestors, those saints who came before us, did not live to see the future they worked for, but they worked for it nonetheless. As my friend Nelda Moraine said in a sermon at Broadway just a month ago, they planted trees that they knew they would never enjoy the shade of. They did not live to see us gather here, but they believe in us. They believe in us. And in the midst of our anxieties, they teach us there is still a way out. The words of the prophets remind us that we will work for a better future where there are no tears and where we will all have a place at the table. Our saints already have a message for us, from Robin, who taught us how to be friends, from Kathy, who modeled determination and love, from Jack, who showed us that gentleness leads to helping others with a twinkle in our eyes, and from Pat, who accepted us with hugs and good food. Their message is that the way they know the way out of our anxiety and fear. Their message is that no matter what happens around us, we make this table bigger. We extend our arms wider, and we embrace with love the life that we have and offer friendship with a twinkle in our eye and the smile of grace on our lips. We live life in all of its fullness. Their voices now join with the other saints in celebration say to us, we know the way out. The way out is to live our lives together fully, authentically, and with as much love and grit as we can find. We may not all make it in this life exactly the way we want, but we will all make it to the great banquet table to come. This is the good news. This is the gospel of Jesus. And all of God's people with us today and in the past say, amen. Amen.
Please pray with me. O Lord, giver of life and source of freedom, I know that all I have received is from your hand. You call us to be stewards of your abundance, the caretakers of all you have entrusted to us. Help us to always use your gifts wisely, and teach us to share them generously. May our faithful stewardship bring witness to the love of Jesus Christ in our lives. Amen.
Thank you.
As I thought about this Sunday, the phrase, the communion of the saints, kept going through my mind. And I think I understand it a little better now than I did a week ago. When we gather at this table, we are in communion with one another, but we're also in communion with every single person, every single follower of Jesus who has come before us, whether they were in this room or in other rooms. As you've heard me say, over the past 2,000 years, we share in our communion with them. Just as we share in the communion of the saints with all of those around the world who this morning have gathered around similar tables in order to, as some believe, come and know the real presence of Christ in the bread and the cup. As others believe, to come to remember the deep love of God shown us in Christ through taking the bread and the cup. All of us believing that we are part of that community of saints and that God's Spirit is with us. On the night before he died, Jesus sat down at dinner with his friends. At the beginning of the dinner, he took a loaf of bread. He blessed it, and then he broke it into pieces, and then he handed the pieces of bread to his friends. And he said to them, "Just as I give you this bread, so I give you my life." At the end of the meal, Jesus took a cup. He filled it with wine, and then he shared that cup with his friends. And he said to them, "This cup represents a new way of living, of loving one another, of following me. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, remember me." We will be sharing the bread and the cup by passing them down the pews this morning. Those who are going to help us with communion, come forward at this time. And may we all join our hearts together as we receive the bread and the cup of Christ. This is the bread of life, the body of Christ. We share the bread together. This is the cup of grace, the blood of Christ. We share the cup together. Will you pray with me? It is in this communion, in this gathering, in this being together, in this sharing of a table, that we know the bread of life and the cup of grace. God, fill us with that. Fill us to overflowing with life and grace so that it spills over onto others. Amen.
As we close today in worship, I invite you to stand as you are able as we sing verses 1, 2, and 3 of hymn 611, Rise Up, O Saints of God.
This morning's been different. This morning has touched me deeper than I'm normally touched in worship. And it's because of those of you who shared the lives of the folks that you love, who shared their lives with me and with each other. It's because of the saints who are in these stones and who are in our hearts that I am so deeply moved today. So go. With the words of our ancestors, our saints on your lips, saying we know the way out because the way out is in the hope that Christ has given us. Go filled with the fire in your heart that filled their hearts, that said no matter what we face, no matter what we deal with, no matter who comes in front of us, God is with us and God will bring us through. Go in the name of Jesus who loves us and has brought us together. Amen.